going to talk about painting today. I'm going to talk about writing my new book, Me in Probate. It's a collection of pieces written over the years that somehow never found their way into one of my other books, so I decided to put this collection together. And there's a lot of different things. There's stories, essays, a memoir, film script, this and that, you know. And today I'm going to read one of the excerpts from one of the pieces. It's called My Netflix Recommendations. This was about 7 or 8 years ago, before Netflix started producing their own films. And there were a lot more smaller, independent type films, small budget type films on the website that are no longer there. I don't know why, but the only thing required to find them was, you know, a certain amount of patience that to scroll in and around and through some of the garbage. But they were there to be found, and I found 23 of them that I wound up writing about, that all different. But you know, what I look for in a film, the one thing that I look for in a movie is the element of surprise. You know, I like a movie that I'm watching it and I'm not really sure what's going to happen next, but I'm curious to find out. So those are the type of films that I wound up reviewing, and I'm going to read just a few of these reviews, some of the short ones, and one a little bit longer. So let's get started. This one is called Payday, featuring Rip Torn. Rip Torn is at his best playing an asshole. And in Payday, as country western singer Maury Dan, he finds the role of his dreams. Piano Mania, documentary. Why would anyone watch a movie about a piano tuner? Because this piano tuner is Stefan Knupfer, who works for Steinway, travels around Europe to various concerts to collaborate with the pianist and fiddle with the instrument, and somehow coax from it the required tone, the perfect tone. And I leave it for you to imagine the conversations that result. Musicians are obsessive. Those at the top are the obsessive of the obsessives. But Stephen Knupfer is more obsessive. Brilliant and hilarious. Juliet doesn't date at night. Italian. Why doesn't Juliet date at night? Because Juliet is in jail for murder, to bump off the boyfriend in an angry moment. This is Italy, where they take a more cavalier view of homicide, and extra cavalier if the killer is a beautiful woman. Juliet has allowed her freedom during the day to work as a swim instructor at a local piscina, swimming pool. Day over, she returns to jail. Here at the pool, she has a handful of students, including the daughter of Guido, a writer, happily married, but not for long. Julia is played by Valeria Golino, the most beautiful of all the beautiful Italian actresses. And Valerio Mastandrea, as the writer, is perfect. It's funny, dark, and quite sad. Senna, documentary. Senna is young, great looking, and a Formula One racing prodigy. It's called To Have the World by the Balls. Then he decides to drive in a race. Something tells him not to. The Parking Lot Movie, documentary. Have your car parked by an entertaining collection of artist, student, misfit types who understand the job is a dead end, but for some reason beats everything else out there. Armadillo, documentary. Platoon of Danish soldiers ships off to fight in Afghanistan, where they encounter long periods of boredom, punctuated by short intervals of fighting. They fight and watch porno. Casualties occur on both sides. There is the usual collateral damage, the women, children, and old men, and the occasional cow, goat, or dog blown to bits. Powerful film about the futility of war and this particular war. Bill Cunningham documentary. Bill is a New York Times photographer, bikes around the city shooting women in compelling outfits. Herb and Dorothy documentary. Herb is a mailman. Dorothy works behind the jewelry counter at Macy's in New York. They live in a small apartment made smaller via an art collection of the conceptual type that began 40 years ago. Began on a shoestring. It's now worth $40 million. Meanwhile, the apartment is a problem. There is art, 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 and to eat a meal or visit the bathroom or plop down on the bed for a good night's sleep means navigating around all the art. They are living like refugees. Why don't they sell some of the art? It's a good question. Angela, another Italian film. Angela is married to an older man, the rich older man type, the rich older man mafia don type. It's a simple story. She falls for a younger mafia type. Complications follow. But who can blame the guy? Angela, Donatella Finocchiaro, is phenomenal. Okay, I'm going to read one more, slightly longer review. It's called Queen to Play. It's French. The lead actress is Sandrine Bonnaire. Helene is a chambermaid at a luxury hotel. She's cleaning the room of a young couple who sit outside on the terrace playing chess. She cleans the room from time to time, looks over at the couple and the game, what's going on with the game. The game interests her. A few days later, the house of Helene. She's married with a teenage daughter. The husband works in a shipyard, a blue-collar type. It's his birthday. There's a cake, the opening of presents. He unwraps the wife's present, an electronic chess set. Says, "What's this?" Helene says, "It's a chess set." "I know that. I don't play chess, and you don't play chess." She has a look that says, "We've been married 15 years. Yes, I love you. I'm happy enough, but I'm a little bored. Feel the need of stimulation. Maybe if we learn to play chess, something might happen, called fun." The husband is willing enough, but after a few attempts to humor his wife, he throws in the towel. The game means nothing to him, but not to her. There's something about this game that has inserted itself into the inquisitive or curious part of the brain, and it nags her. She sets out to teach herself chess. She stays up late after the husband turns in, breaks out the chess set, begins to play. It's electronic, so she can play against the set, the software. It was at this point I said to myself, "I think we have something here." Enter Kevin Kline, speaking French. He's a professor but doesn't teach. We don't know why. Maybe the students hate him. He's the loner type, not overly fond of people, a widower, seems to be nursing some tragic secret. Helene comes over once a week on her day off to do the house. Here she is cleaning, notices something for the first time, a chess set inserted between books on the shelves. She says to Kevin Kline, "Do you play chess?" "Yes." Pause. "Would you teach me to play?" Kevin Kline gives her a look. "You're kidding me." He says, "Pardon me? Would you teach me to play chess? I'm trying to learn on my own, but it's hard, and I feel the need for a teacher. I'd be happy to clean the house in return for lessons." Another look from Kevin Kline. "Darling, you're here to clean the house, not for me to teach you chess, okay?" He says, let me think about it. But what Kevin Klein doesn't know is Haleen is the persistent type. Back at the house the following week, she says, have you thought about the chess lessons? A long look from Kevin Klein. He isn't too fired up about this idea. He says, be here Tuesday afternoon at 2:00. The lessons begin. First game lasts 2 minutes. Four moves, the classic fool's mate gambit. The second game lasts 5 minutes, 6 moves. Game 3 is more of the same. So it goes, but what Kevin Klein has failed to anticipate is chess has become an obsession for Haleen. And as we know, beware the person with an obsession. On with the lessons. She continues to improve. The improvement is startling. There's a ripple effect to all this chess, which is to breathe a little life into Kevin Klein, to revive him from his coma, perk him up, and even to speak in complete sentences, sometimes kindly. He also sees the writing on the wall that one day, sooner and sooner rather than later, Haleen will grease him. Meanwhile, there are complications. With the job over at the hotel and her family life at home, she's become a chess zombie, and everything else in her life has been assigned to second place, or even not to exist. The job is a problem because the floors of the hotel are designed chess style, with the black and white tiles, and the effect is to induce in Haleen a trance, mop in hand, pondering moves. On with the chess lessons over at the house of Kevin Klein. She has him on the ropes. There are a handful of draws, and then she greases him. And, classy dude or no, he feels the pain. It's annoying. But he recovers, says to her, there's a chess tournament about to begin at Chambéry. Do you know of it? Yes, I have heard. You must enter it. She says nothing. Kevin Klein says, Haleen, you have a gift. An extraordinary gift. Where did it come from? We don't know. It's a mystery, like asking Beethoven how he wrote all that music. The important thing is to exploit the gift, to squeeze every drop of juice from the gift. Comprende tu? That's the film. She enters the tournament and, of course, wins the tournament. The prize is 1,500 euros and a trip to Paris for the national championship. But what about romance? Love and some rousing sex scenes between Haleen and Kevin Klein. There's a powerful attraction, but nothing happens because the director understands it's a film about chess, not screwing. And also, we find out towards the end, Kevin Klein is dying. There's a single kiss, a bon voyage kiss, as she prepares to leave for Paris. A wonderful scene. Well, that's the essay, my Netflix recommendations. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you did enjoy it, maybe you will check out the book on Amazon. Okay, so thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.